The Holy Roman Empire was a group of roughly 300 principalities who gathered in Central Europe under the Christian faith, encompassing the territories of present-day Germany and Austria. The emperor was not chosen by descent. He was elected by seven electors and crowned by the Pope. Prosperity began with the journey of one man, an emperor with the nose of an eagle, the pedigree symbol. His name was Maximilian I. Maximilian, known as the last knight of the Middle Ages, roamed a borderless Europe, married the princess of the land of the windmill, spoke many languages, and built a golden capital at the foot of the Alps. It was the beginning of a new era of Europe's preeminent prosperity in the world. During Maximilian's childhood years, the Dukedom of Burgundy had expanded its territory from present-day Bourgogne, France, to the Netherlands and Belgium. Facing the North Sea, the Netherlands and Belgium, or Flanders as it was known, was bustling with ocean traffic coming from all parts of Europe. Maria, Princess of Burgundy, and Maximilian, Prince of Habsburg, were engaged to be married. It had been the wish of both families, as Burgundy wanted the emperor's position and Habsburg yearned for economic affluence. Just at that time, the King of Burgundy lost his life in a war with the Swiss army. The letter arrived for Maximilian out of the blue. It was from his fiancée, Maria. I need you to come to my side, to my country. Please believe me when I tell you I will keep my promise to father and marry you. Please hurry. Please come and save my country. Save me. In the summer of 1477, 6 months after receiving that letter, Maximilian arrived in Brussels, the capital of Flanders. Here, Maximilian was joined in matrimony with Maria, who would become monarch of Burgundy. Maximilian took great efforts to learn the Burgundian culture and its systems. His wife Maria taught in the languages of Burgundy as well as French. In The White King, his autobiography, he explains.
The White King was pressured into learning the language spoken by his wife in order to rule her country. He eventually came to understand and write the language as if it were his own.
Maximilian himself is portrayed as the White King. Maximilian also learned Flemish from a lady of the imperial court.
As the White King came to speak the language of the people felt a great satisfaction and fostered a special love for the king.
Still, as an outsider, Maximilian had other problems. Cambrai, a town situated on the border between the Holy Roman Empire and France, was taken over by the French immediately after Maria's father's death. Having grown up in the spirit of chivalry, Maximilian naturally thought it was his duty to fight. He traveled from town to town fighting the French army.
what a pathetic man I am. I have not eaten, slept, or even taken a walk since I arrived. Work, work, work. I have no time to myself.
Maximilian needed money to fight the war. He created new taxes, such as beer tax, to make money from the people. However, such one-sided measures did not sit well with the people of Flanders. In 1482, Maria, monarch of Burgundy, fell off of her horse and died. It had only been 5 years since their marriage. She left behind two young children, aged 2 and 4. In response to her last will and testament, Maximilian took over the responsibilities of ruling the nation as a regent. The Burgundy territory was to be inherited by Maximilian Habsburg's son. After having lost his beloved wife, further pain and trouble were awaiting Maximilian. Neighboring France had secretly been approaching citizens who were unhappy about their taxes being raised. Urged by the French, angry merchants of Bruges rose up against Maximilian. Maximilian was imprisoned in a house owned by a pepper merchant. Maximilian's aides and confidants were consecutively executed in plain view from the window. It was an act of protest against a ruler who was an outsider, who threatened the rights of the citizens. Caught in a dilemma, Maximilian wrote to his father, the emperor, for help. 3 months later, the help came. The imperial army put a stop to the citizens' revolt. Flanders was now, in reality and in name, under Habsburg rule. From then on, Maximilian, who had been pushed into a corner in the conflict, went through a big change in this unfamiliar culture. He started to actively incorporate the things he had learned from the merchants. In 1489, a battle broke out to the south of the empire. It was a battle between Tyrol, at the foot of the Alps, and its neighbor, Bavaria. Maximilian offered to mediate between the countries, both to which he was related. Thus began his days of traveling back and forth between Burgundy and Tyrol. The reason for the battle was a significant sum of money loaned by Bavaria to Archduke Sigmund of Tyrol, using Tyrolean land as collateral. Sigmund would not pay it back. In 1490, the battle was settled on the condition that Maximilian would claim Tyrol, including its debt. Setting the capital in a town called Innsbruck, surrounded by alpine mountains, Maximilian got busy on an economic reform to pay back the loan. Merchants started coming to Innsbruck, Maximilian's capital, from everywhere. In 1493, Maximilian married his second wife, Bianca, daughter of the Duke of Milan. They lived in the palace at Innsbruck. With this marriage, Maximilian became de facto ruler of Milan. Tyrol gained even more importance in the empire. In 1493, with the death of Friedrich III, Maximilian was selected to be Emperor of the Holy Roman Empire. The throne for emperors chosen by turn from the very beginning. However, Habsburg had already become a family of overwhelming presence. Maximilian traveled the vast empire, which he alone was expected to govern. To Burgundy, to Tyrol, to Vienna, to Italy.
I am alive, yet how much longer I shall live, I do not know. My journey continues, yet how far I shall go, I do not know. Strangely, I am happy.
In his journey to the south, he battled his old enemy France over Italian territorial rights.
Italy is mine. I will not tolerate the French guarding its gate.
On his journey east, he was successful in taking back Vienna, which had become occupied by Hungary during his father's era. Complying with his father's wishes, Maximilian returned the coffin of his father, Friedrich III, which had been taken out of Vienna for safekeeping, and laid it to rest at St. Stephen's Cathedral. Maximilian made use of the abundant resources from Tyrol's mines and built a weapons factory in Innsbruck. He hired qualified tradesmen from across the empire. Tyrolean tradesmen could make resistant armor helmets by hammering steel twice. The Flemish, on the other hand, were able to make thin armor. By cutting grooves into the surface, strong, light armor was created. This is Maximilian's suit of armor. The weight covering the entire body is only 18 kilograms. In culture and in technology, Maximilian adapted the talents of the diverse populace and spread them throughout the empire. What he did not do was unify the language. This was in respect for the cultures of the various ethnic groups. The age gave birth to a multi-ethnic nation only a Habsburg could create. In the autobiography, the king shares his shields, armor, and other treasures with the people. Maximilian's ideal king was forever in pursuit of the people's wealth. The White King has the people draw paintings, build structures, and make musical instruments. The real Maximilian also spent all of his earnings from Tyrol on the arts without hesitation. As Maximilian spent more and more time on the road, he eventually decided to have his musicians travel with him. In addition to ceremonies at destinations, he would have them perform for him privately during the journey. The House of Habsburg expanded its territory through marriage. They would add Burgundy, Spain, Portugal, Hungary, Bohemia, and the new continent, America, to the empire. The empire had grown so large that it came to be called the country on which the sun never sets, establishing an overwhelming position in Europe. Being crowned by the Pope, the family chosen by God was destined to protect Catholicism. The traitor Fugger, who had been protected by Maximilian, had been dealing in pardons. This caused a great uproar, which led to a religious revolution in the 16th century. Protestants, members of the new religion, formed together in a fight against Catholic corruption. The imperial family did their best to oppress the attackers. As a result, the Netherlands dropped out of Habsburg hands, declaring independence. The empire was shaken. When the Spanish Habsburgs, who led the oppression, ran out of heirs to the throne, their territories were taken over by the House of Bourbon in France. Meanwhile, the Austrian Habsburgs were welcoming a new age of prosperity. Vienna, which used to be way off in the east, had become a leading European city under Maria Theresa, attracting travelers from all areas. The integration of the peoples brought together by Maximilian, though under a certain amount of tension, was in full throttle.